Hi, I'm Tatiana Bazzichelli. I'm the curator of the exhibition Network Disruption, produced by Axioma. And I would like to start this short guide by introducing the concept of network disruption. And this diagram has been also part of the book that I published some years ago with the same title, and has been also a bit of the inspiration for creating this exhibition. And it's important to describe that in the diagram, the main points are art, business, and disruption. And in the center, there are different agents that act, like artists, hackers, activists, entrepreneurs, and networkers. Because if we speak about disruption, this is a term that comes from a business culture. And we can say that disruption happens when a product or a technology is introduced in the market and provoke a transformation that the market doesn't expect. And I'm mutuating the discourse of disruption into the art field, and the idea is to imagine and to describe practices that are also unpredictable and that are creating a transformation, a perturbation that are unexpected. And the idea is really to try to create a sort of the tournament from business culture to art, activism, and technology information to start to imagine a different way of political, economical, and technological criticism. And the criticism comes from within the system. As the disruption comes from inside the market, if we speak about business, then the same we could say that the agents that I was describing before are acting inside the field of the systems that they want somehow to criticize. So the shift is that we are not mainly speaking about opposition, like frontal opposition, but we are speaking about a different strategy that comes from the inside of the systems and adopts virality, perturbation, also the idea of creating something that is unpredictable or unexpected inside a closed structure. This room is the start of the exhibition, and I would like to first introduce a bit of work that we have here, and I have to say that this exhibition is a network of networks. So I created a network among different practices that not necessarily fit, but I'm trying also to follow a path that in my mind makes sense, also in the mind of other people, but I'm also telling then the visitors that they could create their own path in the framework of network disruption. And today many people know about the Snowden disclosures because they have been reaching a wide public, and also something I would say really important for the hacker culture, because often we have been speaking about subjects that were not really mainstream, and I think also today the discourse of opening the system and trying to reflect from within the system is reaching the broad public, and that is why the start of the exhibition is with this phenomenon, these activities, and there is a video interview of Snowden by Laura Poitras with Glenn Greenwald that has been really fundamental for the start of this reflection about the Snowden disclosures. And I also think it's a piece that has a really great artistic value and aesthetic. That is why I also thought it's not only important for the movement, but also for the artistic background that this brings, referring also to the work of Laura Poitras. And the other video is from Trevor Paglen, and is a conceptual filming from above of the GCHQ base in UK. And this is also related with the idea of Trevor Paglen of exposing and revealing something that is often invisible or difficult to access, at least for the common people. And in that sense, I think it's a really great combination because brings the discussion into what is actually accessible for us, how we could imagine art that is evidence, and most of all also reflects on the fact that thanks to whistleblowers now we are able to understand how system of powers are working from the inside. And on the other side, we have instead a work from Julian Oliver that is a really recent work that he just did for our exhibition, and is referring to also a debate that is happening right now that is related to the openness of the Snowden disclosures, and also what is actually accessible for us, in which way we can understand this information, because many of these files are really highly bureaucratic language, and even for the journalists that have these files, it's really difficult to process in time the information and deliver them to the public. So Julian had the idea also to, as is his usual style, to mix up a bit with these codes and also put together some fake templates that he created with the same PowerPoint slides of the style of the NSA and GCHQ. And at the same time, if you go into this cabinet, that also reminds a bit, you know, the highly bureaucracy level that often these things bring along, you can explore and you could find some leaks, and you don't know if these leaks are real or fake. And actually, we can also say that there are real Snowden leaks, but it's up to the public to try to discover that and understand actually what they are looking. And this is also something important to reflect about, actually, what is real, what is unreal, what is possible for us to process in this sea of data and information that we are right now put inside. And this is the room that we dedicated to Anonymous and also Neoism. And something important that I want to say is that I created this exhibition also in collaboration with many people, of course, Janez Jansa from the Axioma production, but specifically for each of the room, also with people that are in a part of the groups that are under analysis and scrutiny, if you want. And at the same time, this has been a really important collaboration because it allowed me to create something that is about networks, but also to reflect from the inside of these networks with people that are participating actively inside them. And for the Anonymous section, I've been collaborating with Gabriella Coleman. And what we thought was that it's important to create the path of Anonymous in a way that is good to show the different faces of the entity, because Anonymous, as we know, is nobody and everybody, everyone, and everybody could be Anonymous if you decide to do it. So the really important aspect is that there is not a political mandate, there is not a political agenda that is fixed, but each people could become Anonymous just by being themselves and decide to do certain actions. And in this room, so there is a path that goes from the early Anonymous operations and even intervention when still the Anonymous people were acting inside 4chan and also channels that had more to do with the activity of trolling, of working and playing for the lulz. And so we have one of the first video message, Dear Mr. Fox, that is an answer of Anonymous to Fox News. And it's really interesting, this video, because it's basically defining what Anonymous is by not defining it, but actually showing what Anonymous is capable of, and at the same time also leaving the freedom to interpret what Anonymous could be. And so the path that we are following is to combine both an aspect that is referring to the pleasure, the lulz of doing certain action, and the most political one. And here we have a photo from Lucas Jackson during the Ferguson protest. And we wanted really to refer to an activity that is contemporary and also the idea that's anonymous since actually 2008, also with the Scientology operation started to reflect deeply on the discourse of freedom and also of rights, civil rights, and also trying to expose bugs that are in political, economical, and technological systems. And one work that is really important that we decide to have is the front page of the anti-sec zine that is referring to the Stratfor hack that Jeremy Hammond did. And this is really an important document because we know that Jeremy Hammond now is in prison for 10 years. And we decide exactly to show this front page because it's a moment in which anti-sec and Anonymous are exposing also bugs from the Stratfor corporation and also the misconduct of the corporation itself. And at the same time, we also have a comment on Stratfor from Barrett Brown, and Barrett Brown as well for this specific situation and case has been in prison for 63 months because also he assisted the Anonymous into this operation, published the link to this specific information that were leaked by Jeremy Hammond, and at the same time, there have been also other charges, but what is important for us is really to reflect on what does it mean to work with secret information today, what are the boundaries between legal and illegal, and most of all, what are the rights of these people that are trying to expose misconducts or corporation or governmental agency and operate an act of whistleblowing that is also serving the civil society. On the other side, we have the section related to Neoism, and I've been collaborating for putting it up with Florian Kramer, that has been part of the Neoist group since the 80s. The idea for this specific section was to try to disrupt as well the strategies of curatorial decisions, because we thought for a group as Neoism that work on the idea of destructuring your own identity and be able all to use the Monty Kantian identity, then we could have not done a show in which we decide what Neoism is. So we are asking the people basically to decide by themselves. We created a selection of different works that have been part of the Neoist mythology, symbolism, propaganda, action, photos of apartment festival, and we are asking the public just to put the things they like on the wall and in that sense build up the section of Neoism. At the same time, people can also browse to different video material of the Neoist experience and listen to some songs that have been produced by Neoist members. And then finally, we have the Neoist chair that has been also used by many Neoists in various occasions that really shows how you can become a Neoist. So basically, you just sit and you are finally Monty Kantian, and in that sense, I am a Neoist. And this is really showing how this specific movement works, that is a sort of playful appropriation of concepts, of identity, and also playing with the discourse of what is the truth, what are the definitions that we put into our life and we embody with our bodies. And this is the male art area, and for that I've been collaborated strictly with Vittore Baroni, and with Vittore we decided to, from one side, show a timeline of various male art works that have been done through the year, and we have to say that male art is a path, is a movement, is a series of projects that have been involving many people, actually even people say since the 50s, but more or less we know that the time of maximum involvement have been the 80s and also from the end of the 70s on. And we wanted to give also an historical dimension to that by choosing some works that also have to do with the concept of disruption, because male art has been a movement that has been disrupting the postal system as well by self-producing postal stamp, briefs, letters, and different materials that have been also serving for many times to circumvent censorship and get in contact with many people also in places in which was not possible to do. On the down part, instead, we decide to create an open call on the line of disruption and ask the people of the mail art circuit to participate by sending to the gallery scooch a work that is interpreting the discourse of network disruption. So we have a lot of new works that around 130 artists, postal artists sent to us, and we are then creating this dialogue among the two different timelines. And here instead there is a work that in Italian is called Il tavolo del piccolo iconoclasta, that means the table of the small iconoclast, the little iconoclast, and we then have the possibility just to take some shoes and create some stamp. And this also is playing with the discourse of the originality of art, the hierarchy of art, and by art always say that art should be easy, could be also be used by anybody, and we should also try to dismantle the usual hierarchy that we have in art institutions. And I think this is also a disruptive way of showing that, and also pretty playful. This specific room is dedicated to the practices of Society Club, Cacophony Society, and the Billboard Liberation Front, and has been done in collaboration with John Law, that is also participating at the seminar, and we decided to show some video extracts of different situations and interventions that the people did from San Francisco and also spread all over the US. And all these practices have to do a lot with the idea of creating pranks and interventions that are totally disruptive in the city urban field, but also in the business of advertisements and at the same time in the everyday life. So it's important to say that the Suicide Club that started in 1977 until 1983 was coming also from the experience of the Comm University in San Francisco, and was trying to imagine, for example, how we could live our day, our life, as it would be the last one, the last day of our life. And in that sense, they were doing really radical practices, like trying to climb by hands the Golden Gate Bridge of San Francisco, or doing exploration underground, and constantly try to play also with norms that could be opened up and dismantled to create a new form of imagination and also inspiration. And it's important to say that these practices have been totally central also for the development of Burning Man and Burning Man Festival, that is this big festival in Northern Nevada, would have never been possible without the activity of the Suicide Club, Cacophony Society, and the Billboard Liberation Front, that also played a lot with cultural jamming, advertisements, and adbusting. We enter now in the biggest room of the exhibition, that is strictly related with the idea of business disruption, but also disruption of closed systems that have to do with information and communication. So the first project is the Luther Blisset, and this project has also been conceptualized for this specific exhibition with some people of the Luther Blissett project. I would say that Luther Blissett has been a total mythology for many people, not only in Italy, that is the place where it started in 1994, but also all over the world. And the idea was that everybody could become Luther Blissett. You could embody the Luther Blissett character in your everyday life and use the name of Luther Blissett for the activity you wanted to do, and in that sense act in the name of Luther Blissett, but also in your own name, because that became actually what you were. And the important aspect of Luther Blissett was to try to play with the system of information and media monopoly or media communication. And through the course of the project have been done a lot of pranks to media organizations to show that also often newspaper and journalists are not following specific ethical rules, but they are, for example, writing about sources that are not really checking. And so Luther Blissett was infiltrating in this bug in the system, showing that was possible to build up a narrative, an urban legend that often the media were catching and reporting about as it was real. And then Luther Blissett was revealing that this is was not. Not only was able to expose bugs in the system, but also create a network of practices that were real fun for a lot of people, and practices that were also using the network of the mail art, or the BBS at the time, and people were also producing a lot of information, like totally underground, do-it-yourself publications that were created, but also publications that then were done by different independent publishing houses, like the AAA edition was really important, the one created by Vittorio Barioni and Pier Mario Ciani. But also many other publications that were done until the very last of Luther Blissett that was made by the collective that later took the name Wuming and was the book Coup. And we have also a video with actually the real Luther Blissett, because Luther Blissett was a physical person, was a football player, and we have here a football show in which the real Luther Blissett is getting to know the fake Luther Blissett, and there is a lot of fun misunderstanding and the discourse about what means to have a shared identity and what this means. This other project is named Anna Damolo, and is also continuing the threads because people from the Anomalous Wave movement, a student movement between 2008 and 2009 in Italy, decide to create a fictional identity that had the name of Anna Damolo, that is the acronym of Onda Anomalous, that is a Thailand name for Anomalous Wave. And they create this identity because they wanted to work on the discourse of unrepresentability in a political movement. So a movement that doesn't want to be represented by political party flags or political strict mandates, but wants to have to do directly with the subjectivity of the single individual. And this character that they created, according to them, was the wave minister that could replace the minister for research and education and university, Maria Stella Gelmini. And that was the name of the minister at the time. And they first created the Gelmini's Facebook profile, the official one, because the real politician still didn't have. And then they transform it progressively into the one of Anna Damolo, the day of the national strike, by creating a viral activity in which then everybody started to become Anna Damolo using Facebook, the fictional identity profile. And also this profile and this identity was used in the street during the demonstration. And we have, for example, here some tools that the people were using in the protest, like the purple glasses that also the prime the minister of education and research usually adds. but this was belonging to the people, as, for example, the fake website of the ministry program that they created, that initially looked like the original one, but then was bringing to another fake one, that was the one that could belong to the people themselves, that could also phone a telephone number and express their own experience in this protest. Another work is a Seppuku, that's the collective Lelians Invisible did conceptualized in 2008 and was launched in 2009. That is also referring directly to the Luther Blissett experience. That is also why we have Luther Blissett there, but not only, and I will explain. The idea is that Seppuku is a virtual suicide, is a ritual suicide in Japanese language, and is also the same suicide that Luther Blissett, some people of the Luther Blissett movement did in 1999. And they used this term to create a hack, if you want, of the Facebook deactivating account function, because through Seppuku you could generate your virtual suicide in Facebook. And they were reflecting on the fact that often all these friends we have in Facebook are a total artificial construction, because they are not really our friends, and the company only wants that we are inside to put our data. So they were studying the code, understanding how the deactivate function was working. They replicated that, and through that they allowed the people to commit a virtual suicide and also enter into a top ranking that they created. For example, the person that was committing more suicide was at the top of the ranking and was generating a viral situation. And here we have the different testimonials that also helped the spread of the project. And of course, they are fake testimonials, even if they are real people. I mean, you can see we have a really important personality like Jim Morrison, for example. And we are also showing on the video the virtual suicide of Jim Morrison and how these people are also spreading the information about the project. And here we have the log of the people that committed the suicide. Janne Pianza is another important project inside the exhibition, and we just decided to replicate here the letter that Janne Pianza, Janne Pianza, and Janne Pianza sent to the Prime Minister Janne Pianza by declaring their name change into Janne Pianza. And this is totally an artistic gesture that is showing how it's possible to introduce an element that is disrupting in your everyday life, but at the same time it's also showing how it's possible to create the tournament by also playing with the system of institutional powers, bureaucracy. Yesterday at the seminar we were discussing a lot about the discourse of intimate bureaucracy. And by exhibiting just this letter that, by the way, say that more people will do this, more possibility also will be open, then we show that the name change has actually been done also by many projects here, Luther Blissett, Anna Damolo. It's also an artistic gesture that allows you to create a reflection on many normative mechanisms that are interfering with your everyday life, and also reflect in another way into the society you are part of. And the Google Nest is a totally business disruption project by the Peng Collective in Germany, and was a technology that was introduced at the Republika Festival in 2014. And the two members of the Peng Collective went to the festival by embodying two Google employees that were showing and launching a new project, Google Nest, that had had also different apps that you could use, different different side of the project, like Google Trust, Google Hug, Google Be, and Google Buy, that are all working in a really ironic way with the discourse of surveillance, of big data, of also how corporations like Google are taking our private information to create their own business. But if you read, they are totally ironic, like the Google Bee is a drone that can follow you in an everyday life and also document the most important projects. Google Buy is a memorial you could create it at the end of your virtual life. Then there is also Google Hug, in which you could send somebody to give you a real hug if you need to have it, and also it's playing a lot with the connection and the fake friendship that you can establish online. And finally, Google Trust is also working a lot with who is owning your data, how many data you can actually control, and they are offering you insurance for data protection. And the great thing is that nobody initially understood that they were fake Google sub projects and fake Google employees. And this is also going on in a line that has to do with cultural jamming, ad busting, and also often playing on what is the truth, what is fake, and how I can play in these bugs in the system. We conclude the tour with the Okto P7CES, that means Enterprise Security, and this is a new product from the Okto Corporation that have been following us in many exhibitions also in the past. But this time we have a new brand technology that Okto is producing that is based on the caps lock system. And the idea is that you can download and access an app after inserting a PIN, and then you can use this app to request a capsule in a different station, and the capsule will travel through the pneumatic post network, and at the same time you can receive and send the capsule in different stations. And the idea is that the Okto P7CES is working with the surveillance inside the business situation and an office. So there is a central operator that is surveilling your activity. For example, it's possible to understand what you are sending through the network, and is the only person that could legitimate the sending by controlling the central session. So it's again the centralized system that we are using, always playing with the discourse of centralization of networks. And when the capsule arrives there, somebody can get it, add the contents, and the capsule then will be brought back and could reach the different rooms of the exhibition.